to talk on what is new in acute myeloid leukemia, the perception of...
So it's also a case-based discussion, you involve everybody.
Yeah.
And what's new in hematology also, a little bit you covered, because you have vast knowledge.
Of course. it's pertaining to acute myeloid leukemia. If you, from time immemorial, we know, probably, although it is named as a single entity, acute myeloid leukemia, in clinical practice, we see the heterogeneity, not only in the clinical presentation, and when you employ the routine investigatory modality, you can perceive the difference in the different population. Then, when you start assigning the prognosis in these patients, the predictive ability appears to be wanting. And when you further, when you start treating this patient with your classical time immemorial, we do the 7+3 chemotherapy, we see the difference in the outcome in different patients. And in many patients, we see the inevitable relapse looming large in our minds. Is one of the frustrating, I would say, a disease that we have been treating so long, and still we are not able to do much for the these patients with acute myeloid leukemia. If you look at our day-to-day the practice, as far as the diagnosis is concerned, anything new has come, and which has really contributed in terms of our confirmatory ability with regard to the both sensitivity and specificity. Probably, as in routine hematology practice, we start with a complete blood count, and the older you become, probably you are attached to the previous things you have been trained and you are conversant with. Therefore, my choice probably would be go to the perusal, meticulous perusal of the properly stained peripheral smear and a bone marrow aspirate morphology. The time immemorial, we had been used to that, and we are making the diagnosis only based on these parameters. However, today if you are asked whether you can base your diagnosis on these means alone, I would say no. The answer would be no, because we have learned, over the period of time, the sensitivity of our morphological observations seem to be wanting, and there is a difference between individuals' variation as well as inter-individual variation to the larger extent. The previous years, we used to believe only on our eyes, the eyes seeing the cytochemistry slides prepared from the peripheral smear, or more often the bone marrow aspiration smears, especially the PAS, Sudan black B, and the myeloperoxidase stain smears. Nowadays, you don't have a technician to do these special cytochemical stains. And I have seen more often these have become obsolete in our clinical practice. Inevitably, we have switched over to the modern, easier, as far as the clinicians are concerned, to the flow cytometry study of the immunophenotype of the bone marrow aspirations most often. And here, we have got improvements in the technology yielding you good dividends as far as the ascertaining the blast, whether it belongs to the lymphoblast or the myeloblast. In routine practice, whether there is a role for doing a bone marrow trephine biopsy, many institutions probably would do it as in a routine practice. However, in certain situations, like an acute megakaryoblastic leukemia, where fibrosis is more often seen in the bone marrow, or in those other situations, like post-treatment acute myeloid leukemia, or more often in the elderly, the acute myeloid leukemia following a myelodysplastic syndrome, where the existence of fibrosis is a norm, where your yield in the routine bone marrow aspiration leaves much to be desired, a recourse to the bone marrow trephine biopsy with immunohistochemistry study may be essential. However good one may be in morphology, I think the differentiation between, for example, an L2 lymphoblast and a M0 myeloblast is almost impossible, and the flow cytometry has come to our rescue, and it has improved to some extent the prognostic estimate that we can make both on the from the clinical data and from the laboratory results. If you look at what has been really new in the field of acute myeloid leukemia diagnostic, our understanding, as Dr. Kishore was telling us, of the genome landscape of the acute myeloid leukemia stem cell and the progenitor cell, and the information now we have obtained on the nature of genetic abnormalities in this unique malignancy is somewhat appalling. It's amazing that in the period of around 10 years, we have improved our understanding of the genetic basis of this heterogeneous disease, namely the acute myeloid leukemia. We started studying the entire exome of the acute myeloid leukemia, wherein they have mapped around 200 genes which may be altered. Then they have narrowed down to 23 genes which seems to be all mutated in this acute myeloid leukemia stem cell or the progenitor cell. Out of these 23 cell genes, you have to understand, you have got what we call as a prime causative or the driver mutations, as was mentioned by Dr. Jose, most of them dealing with the DNA translation, methylation status of the DNA, DMT3A, TET2, and next comes the RNA splicing machinery genes. There have been a spectacular discovery of these genetic mutations pertaining to these areas. The most important aspect which we have to remember, when we become old, more than 60, invariably 10% of our cells can carry this mutated, abnormal driver mutations causing acute myeloid leukemia. This is a very interesting observation. What is called as a clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. As such, the existence of these driver mutations in this, what I told these genes, the methylation, hypomethylation, regulation of the methylation of the DNA, these genes seem to be involved in that. Many of the normal individuals seem to possess these mutations. Therefore, what is interesting is a subsequent array of mutations emerging in the genome seem to result in the morphologically evident blast conversion. There seems to be not only a cooperating mutations occurring simultaneously, but there seems to be a sequential event occurring in the genome that paves way for the development of the blast. Therefore, it seems that we allow to understand more on these genomic alterations of the AML. But here lies the main, I think, the basis of clinical heterogeneity we see, the type of treatment that we may start, the response you may expect, or the relapse you may encounter in our day-to-day practice. I think more and more, inevitably, will be pushed to the molecular genetic study as far as the AML. If we allow to know more about it, try to treat it more. I'll start with some of the exciting treatment advances, but of course we don't have personal experience on this. The worst to my mind was an antibody drug conjugate, which we have been using, which we used for some time, and because of the liver toxicity, veno occlusive disease, it went into disrepute. The vasagamycin, gemtuzumab, vasagamycin, the drug antibody conjugate, CD33, is the most important molecule which is expressed in the myeloblast. You got cytotoxic drug calicomycin conjugated to the CD33, and which seems to increase not the initial response rate for acute myeloid leukemia, but they have shown the decreased relapse rate when you use this drug. And now the FDA has approved again. Initially it was given, then they disapproved. Now it has been approved again with a decreased dose, 3 mg/kg. What is interesting is in the cytogenetic group, favorable group, core binding leukemia type, that is the 821 type, especially if you add gemtuzumab vasagamycin, they have decreased the relapse rate. The other example is your acute promyelocytic leukemia. Addition of this gemtuzumab vasagamycin has increased the salvage rate in this treatable acute myeloid leukemia subtype. What is the next important, of course, the exciting, I would say, is the usage of, in an elderly AML, we know the main problem is two as far as the treatment of AML is concerned. The cytogenetic is a sheet anchor. In them, we have a favorable group wherein 7+3 chemo seems to do reasonably well, but a poor cytogenetic group, we know we have to use only a hypomethylating agent. You've got a large chunk, intermediate group, 50% of them who are cytogenetically normal, wherein a recourse to molecular genetics seems to be the order of the day. The usual gene mutations we order, the NPM mutation, the so-called biallelic CEBPA, as well as your c-kit mutation, TP53, and as he was telling, the FL3 mutation. They should form the investigatory armamentarium. They should add up to our investigatory armamentarium when you encounter an acute myeloid leukemia case with a normal karyotyping. They have given a clue for prognosis. For example, the NPM mutation seems to carry the best of the lot. If it is accompanied by a c-kit mutation, the prognostic appears to be a little bad. If it is associated more often with the FLT3 ITD mutation, the prognosis again is guarded. If you have another interesting gene mutation, so what is called as?
Have a concluding remark.
Yeah, I think I'll do that. I'm sorry. Isocitrate dehydrogenase 1 and 2 mutation. Very interesting drug. Enasidinib, another molecular target they have developed, which seems to be have a very useful in these individuals. Our dilemma in treating elderly AMLs have been, to some extent, we have improved, means with the usage of hypomethylating agent. The 5-azacitidine and the decitabine, especially the schedule by the Texas group, 10 days of injection decitabine, have gone a long way in helping us to do something at least for these elderly AMLs, for whom very often we used to say, you have become old, a bad disease, treatment or no treatment doesn't seem to alter the outcome. And that paradigm has changed. And even at the age of 80 years, without much comorbidity, if it is there, we can treat very easily with these hypomethylating agents, which may enhance the survival period in these unfortunate individuals.
Sir, thank
with this
you.
Remark, I would stop.
Thank you so much, sir. I just request Dr. Arun Shashachalam to give few concluding remarks.
Thank you. So to summarize, actually, if you see what happened in 2018, one is prognostication. So AML is a better molecularly profiled. So apart from the CBP and FLT3 and NPM, which we routinely do, we need to do another three or four extra markers, particularly RUNX1, AXL1 and TP53. These three we need to do before restratification the AML because they do tend to do poorly. The other thing is more the age, older the age, more genetic aberration, more aneuploidy, they don't respond well to the chemotherapy. And they do better with the immunomodulators. So azacitidine works better in adverse risk cytogenetics than intermittent favorable. And two extra armamentary that has come. One is, as Dr. Varadarajan sir has said, one is IDH2 mutation. Okay, so that can be targeted. And the next is FLT3 ITD. And in FLT3, one thing extra what I noticed in ESMO 2018 is if FLT3 allelic ratio, that is mutation versus wild type ratio, is more than 0.5, that particular subset benefit better with 90 milligram meter square of DNR. So till now we don't know which patient to put 60 or 90, but this particular subset, one paper was presented where if the ratio is tumor burden is more than 0.5, they benefit more with 90 milligram per meter square of DNR. Then three drugs, mitostarin, we can add along with the induction regimen, and two other drugs, already mentioned, one is quasartinib, and IDH2 inhibitors can be used as a salvage for AML relapse refractory cases. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think everybody, all the panelists will agree with me, hematology has to be a separate session, a separate day, because, and I think in this malignancy, I was going and making the slides, maximum discovery, starting from Hodgkin's lymphoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, monoclonal antibodies, Benetox, so many drugs. We'll have a next day, one full session. Jose, I wish you agree, and I'm sorry with all the panelists, we couldn't go forward, but thanks for coming and making it so interactive. Thank you so much. Next, we move to the last session of today, genitourinary cancer, what's new in 2018. I request Dr. Balasubramaniam to be on stage to chair this session. Dr. Kadiresan, please, I want your presence here to our discussion because our first talk is on surgery for castration-sensitive prostate cancer, and then we get into gossiprilin and castration-resistant. Dr. A.C. Senthil Kumar to make his surgical presentation first. I also invite my panelist, Dr. Ram Kumar. Dr. Kadiresan is already on stage. Dr. S. Shivakumar, Dr. Gangadharan, Dr. Shivakumar, Mohammed Ibrahim, Shakespeare, Dr. Prahlad. Dr. Balaji can also join us because the surgical discussion will be there. Who else? And Dr. J. Balaji, who will give the last concluding remarks. Dr. Vijay Murugan, you are leaving. Okay, thank you. Yes. Yeah, Dr. Senthil, we'll get started. Yes, Dr. Senthil Kumar. Put it on the slides. It's not here. Even Dr. Rajiv can come up on stage because we can continue the discussion here. Come. Yeah, you can come, take a seat.
As the slides are being loaded, we are towards the end of the session, so I will not take much of a time. The topic is on surgery for castration-sensitive prostate cancer. That is the topic given to me. So I will make it as surgery in early prostatic cancers, and is there a role for surgery anywhere else? So that is how I'm going to take it. So. The controversies in prostate are the order of the day. Every 6 months you have, can you get the slides on the screen, please? Every 6 months you have a changing guidelines. So what I went through is the last couple of years, I've looked through what has been new in, with regards to screening, evaluation, and surgical management. I am not going to the territory of the medical oncologist with respect to castration-sensitive or hormone-sensitive tumors. So start with PSA screening. What would be the cutoff for a PSA screening? We started with 9, we came down to 1, then there were some cutoffs for 2.5, and now at 4. What is this level with regards to screening? We'll start with Dr. Balaji. What would you use as your PSA level screening with regards to age?
See, as you currently put it, the level stays at 4. Of course, age-specific markers are there, you know, you have 2.5, then it goes up to 3.5.